The Supermarine 545 was to be one of the first transonic jets in history. Its unique design and powerful features made it a magnificent prototype, and it was known as the British answer to the Mikoyan-Gurevich MiG-19. Aircraft manufacturer Supermarine had cemented itself as one of the most outstanding aircraft developers in the world, and the role its Spitfire played during World War II had a lot to do with its success. The Spitfire came to be seen as Churchill's spearhead during the war. Despite not having the most extraordinary firepower or the fastest engine, it had the most versatile maneuverability, making it the king of dogfights above the English Channel. However, the world was changing, and when there was no more fighting to be done, the demand for single-engine fighters plummeted. At the same time, the need for multi-engine aircraft grew. With little experience outside single-engine planes, Supermarine decided to focus its efforts on building the next generation of jet fighters. Nevertheless, a sequence of disastrous projects and disgraceful accidents slowly lost the trust of the Royal Air Force. Supermarine tried to earn back its reputation in a daring gamble, building the world's first jet fighter capable of reaching Mach 1.3. It would be the aircraft to put Supermarine back on the map and save them from financial ruin. But just as their prototype left the production line, a vast public scandal turned Supermarine's world upside down. Approaching the end of the line. By the time the war was over in 1945, Supermarine had managed to become one of the most vital aircraft developers during the conflict. So important that during the Blitz, Germany made the Supermarine factories a primary objective. Their development centers were bombed on more than one occasion. On September 15, 1940, one of their leading factories in Southampton was raided by 18 ME-110s, each airship deploying two bombs over the area. Fortunately for Supermarine, the bombs detonated in nearby housing areas, and their factory only suffered from a few broken glass windows. During another Luftwaffe raiding strike, a bomb went through a window into the drawing room of one of Supermarine's factories. The explosive did not detonate, saving many of the designs that would eventually help the war effort. The Spitfire fighter developed by Supermarine eventually became the backbone of the Royal Air Force during wartime, and a variant was subsequently developed for the Navy. This airship came to be known as the Seafire. England placed enormous resources into aircraft development, as it knew air superiority was crucial for restraining Hitler's ambitions. Hence, Supermarine enjoyed vast considerations and a massive number of commissions. But as the blasts in Hiroshima and Nagasaki dropped the curtain over the last theater of World War II, Western democracies were desperate to transition into a peacetime economy. Supermarine, whose operation had been widely dispersed to avoid being destroyed in a raiding strike, and whose production consisted mainly of light one-engine fighters, suddenly found itself in serious trouble. Technology had also changed abruptly, and now aircraft manufacturers were rushing to develop the first jet-engine aircraft. Supermarine saw jet technology as the only way to move forward, and started working on the Attacker during the early 1950s. Using the basic structure of a Spitfire, while housing a powerful Rolls-Royce Avon turbojet engine, the Attacker became the first jet fighter to be used by the British forces. This milestone only provided Supermarine a short relief from their growing pressures. First-generation jet aircraft were being replaced at an unprecedented speed, and they hurried to develop the Supermarine Swift as an improvement to their Attacker. The situation became even more dire as the Attacker displayed many shortcomings and performed far below design expectations. The Royal Air Force, or RAF, was growing impatient with Supermarine as other aircraft manufacturers were producing better quality jet prototypes. Enter the Supermarine 545, the last-ditch effort by the company to stay afloat and reinstate its reputation as one of the most essential aircraft developers in the world. The stakes were higher than ever. A promising design. By the early 1950s, Supermarine and Hawker, two juggernauts in aviation development, were competing to create the fastest jet fighters for the RAF. The Royal Air Force needed a capable fighter to reach transonic speeds while waiting for jet engine technologies to advance and produce a supersonic capable aircraft. Both companies then proposed impressive design plans to the RAF, the Supermarine 545 and the Hawker P-1083. Less than a month after their submission, the development of both projects was approved. The race was on, and the reputation of Supermarine was on the line. Supermarine's objective was to win the development race while also avoiding all the shortcomings and flaws presented by the Swift. On paper, their 545 fighters could reach Mach 1.3 speeds. Such swiftness would put the aircraft right in the border between transonic speeds and supersonic speeds, while also superseding the rates projected by the Hawker P-1083, which barely reached Mach 1. The reason behind the confident projections was the mighty Rolls-Royce Avon turbojet engine intended to power the jet fighter. The Rolls-Royce Powerhouse was the first axial flow jet engine to be produced by the company. The 545 model bore a fundamental similarity to the previous Swift, but the likeness was superficial. In truth, the Swift design was utterly overhauled when outlining the blueprints for the 545. When looking at the 545 design, its most outstanding characteristic was its unconventional crescent-shaped wings, which were supposed to aid the aircraft, especially when reaching supersonic speeds. Meanwhile, its bullet-shaped fuselage was also intended to help achieve the unprecedented rates projected by the engineering team. To avoid the poor low-speed handling features of the Swift, the lower section of the 545's hull was compressed around the intersection with the wings to smooth airflow. In addition to the wing and nose designs, these modifications gave the aircraft a unique futuristic look that didn't resemble anything designed during World War II. Paying for past sins. Supermarine had its whole future hanging on by a thread, and that thread was the 545. Nevertheless, the design seemed remarkable, and the development of two prototypes was approved in 1952. All the company had to do was deliver an aircraft capable of performing adequately, and they would overcome their past financial and political inadequacies. Everything was on track for a remarkable comeback. Unfortunately, as Supermarine threw everything into the 545 projects, they neglected to address other important matters. The Swift had been a problematic aircraft since its beginnings. Still, by 1953, more and more reports were coming in of its terrible technical flaws. Due to lack of resources or underestimating the severity of the issue, Supermarine failed to resolve the many flaws pilots encountered while flying the Swift. The latter became an embarrassment for the Royal Air Force, whose opinion of the Supermarine Corporation was less and less favorable with each passing month. The situation reached a boiling point by 1954, when a series of catastrophic accidents involved the Swift, and one of these accidents turned out to be fatal. The shortcomings of the Swift could no longer be kept from the press. A national scandal humiliated the RAF for their handling of the Swift development cycle and their inability to address its faults. The whole ordeal became a political outrage as Parliament demanded an explanation for the tragedies. In August of 1954, all Swift units were permanently grounded. The national outrage destroyed Supermarine's reputation and greatly affected the RAF and the British aircraft industry. Even worse, public opinion began to develop a strong distrust of aircraft development projects. The 545, being a design so closely associated with the now infamous Swift, had to pay the consequences of its predecessor's shortcomings. In 1955, all work and development on Type 545 were abruptly halted, and the project was cancelled entirely. All its design achievements and development progress disappeared from one moment to the next. Two prototypes were partially built, but neither of them would ever fly. One of the airframes was later used as a training device for RAF pilots. For 10 years, it aided students trying to become jet pilots, but it also served as a reminder of the jet fighter which was never meant to be. The Supermarine Corporation completely fell from the government's grace. Ruined and engulfed in constant public scandals, the aircraft manufacturer abandoned its craft and turned to household products. For a time, they produced filmmaking equipment and then switched to making Marine VA-3 hovercraft. However, both endeavors would prove ultimately fruitless, as the downward momentum the company was experiencing could not be halted. Naturally, the RAF chose the Hawker P-1083 as the first British transonic prototype, and continued to commission this corporation for many years to come. For Supermarine, the struggles continued, and in 1957, they were entirely absorbed by parent company Vickers Limited. The last aircraft to ever bear the Supermarine name was the Supermarine Scimitar, a single-seat naval strike aircraft that performed adequately, but still was not able to save the fading company. The last Scimitars left the factory floor in 1957. Supermarine's mythical legacy in the world of aviation and warfare was over, and the factories that brought the world the legendary Spitfire and changed history finally closed for good. Thank you for watching our video. Do you think the Supermarine 545 would have been a success? Let us know in the comment section below. And if you liked our video, click that thumbs up button and help us reach more people. Also, don't miss any of our exciting history-inspired videos by subscribing to all of our Dark Documentaries channels.